Released on September 1st, 2009, Guitar Hero 5 takes the full band gameplay of World Tour and modifies it so that it separates itself from the previous game, but keeps the general feel and sees a big overhaul in graphics. New game modes were introduced and changes were made to the career mode. It fine-tuned all the rugged edges World Tour had, so everything's smoother and fits in with Guitar Hero. Without further ado, let's analyze everything Guitar Hero 5 has to offer. Guitar Hero 5 sees some big differences from World Tour in terms of gameplay and the flow of things. Let's talk about some of the general changes. Players can now jump into the gameplay of Guitar Hero on the attract mode, even if it's in the middle of a song, regardless of which instrument is being played. Players are given menus that they can navigate through to choose their difficulty, choose a new song, or create a playlist, among other options. Players can set up the people that play in their band, so that the other rockers aren't being played by randomly generated custom characters. Expert Plus mode is a new mode where players hook up two kick pedals up to their drum set and play songs that utilize double bass pedals. Expert Plus mode first appeared in Guitar Hero Metallica, but 5 marks its first appearance in a mainstream Guitar Hero. Another feature that came from Guitar Hero Metallica is the Star Meter. The Star Meter shows the player's score, and it shows how far away the player is to getting the next star. The vocal system wasn't changed too much. Players still have to sing certain chords in order to score points, and the amount of points they get is dependent on their performance on each phrase. There's now a bar on the top of the vocals box that shows how good the player has sung the current phrase, with green meaning the most points awarded, and red meaning the least amount of points being awarded, and a drop on the performance meter. Star power is now given whenever a player nails a phrase that is marked as a star power phrase. The freestyle sections of the vocals don't do too much in this game. It really only gives the player a slight increase on their rock meter. There's a karaoke style vocal system players can use, which shows the words of the song, but not the pitches. In World Tour, band streaks would give players points depending on how long the streak was. Guitar Hero 5 sorta has this, but instead of rewarding a certain amount of points for the streak, if the players hit a certain section that's highlighted on their highways, they'll add on to the band's multiplayer for a short period of time. There's more multiplayer modes this time around that are featured under the Rockfest mode. Let's start with the first one, Momentum. Everybody starts at medium, and their difficulty increases as they continue to perform well. Streakers. Streaks give players points, so they better hit every note that they can, or else they risk losing. Perfectionist. Players are ranked on their percentage of how much notes they hit in a section. The player with the highest percentage gets the most points, and the player with the lowest percentage gets the least amount of points. Do or die. Players will have to do their best for each section of a song, because if they miss 3 notes in a row, they will have to wait until the next section starts and miss out on points. Elimination. For every section, the lowest scoring player is eliminated until there is only one player remaining. Pro Face-Off. This is the same game mode from previous Guitar Heroes. Players play a song the whole way through, and whoever has the most points wins. These game modes are pretty fun, and the player can either battle their friends locally or over the internet. Players can battle all their friends, or they can team up as a band and take on other bands over the internet. Let's move on to the career mode of this game. The career mode of this game follows the venue from venue gameplay of previous games, however, it gives it a little twist. The cash system from previous games was abandoned, and players can earn new items via stars. Stars can be earned from doing well on songs and completing challenges in the career mode. The challenges can range from keeping a 4x multiplier for a certain amount of time, obtaining as much points as possible, to hitting enough star power phrases. The challenges are also tied to a certain instrument, and as such, the challenge uses the unique gameplay of the instrument to make it fun and unique. For example, some drum challenges require the player to hit as many snares or kicks as they can. There's also band challenges, where players will have to grab their friends in order to get rewarded. Anyways, there's 3 different tiers to these challenges. Gold, Platinum, and Diamond, and players will need to reach one of these three tiers in order to obtain the locked item. Gold gives 1 star, Platinum gives 2 stars, and Diamond gives 3 stars towards the player's career progression. The beginning of the game starts with players only having to reach Gold, but as the game progresses, they will have to reach Platinum or Diamond in order to finish a challenge. Players can see their progress in the bottom left of the HUD, and the record will change accordingly as players reach the requirements for these tiers as the song goes on. Not only that, but the challenges will also get harder as players go through the career. Challenges can unlock character outfits, new accessories, new instruments, extras, cheats, and even a secret venue. There's also challenges where players pick a song of their choosing and complete the presented challenge with the instrument presented. Anyways, new venues are unlocked after the player has achieved enough stars in order to move on. Pros can breeze through the game by FCing songs and getting diamond for most challenges, while amateurs will have to complete more songs to fulfill the star requirements for new venues. Speaking of FCing songs, players can also earn an extra star by 100%ing a song without losing their note streak. GH Tunes is back this time, and it's improved in many ways, but it's still lackluster with its awkward UI and navigation. There's also GH Jam, where players pick a style of rock to play, and then just jam away by strumming at their guitar, or playing their drums. Guitar Hero 5 takes a huge turn in terms of visuals, and for a game released in 2009, it looks really good. There's something about the shading and details that work with the venues and characters, so that everything looks defined and high quality. Guitar Hero 5 has darker lighting than World Tour, and uses this to its advantage to give more detail and polygons to the environment and characters. The menus in this game lean more towards the menus of earlier games rather than World Tour's menus. As players navigate their way through the game, they'll find artwork that looks similar to the pre-venue posters found in Guitar Hero 1 and 2, although they fit quite well into Guitar Hero 5's visuals. Also, whenever a player chooses a song in career mode, they'll get to see a fun fact about the song or band. Some are more in-depth than others, but they're cool regardless, and just something to spice the game up a little bit. That's all I had to say about the menus. Let's talk about the venues. The venues this time around are really good, a lot better than what World Tour had to offer. They're full of personality and they're quite varied. The venues exude energy and know how to create a unique environment. World Tour's venues were kind of boring and sometimes repetitive, but Guitar Hero 5's venues, on the other hand, are awesome and nothing feels repetitive. Now, it's time for the mandatory explanation of the venues. The 13th Rail. This stage takes place in a subway underneath New York City, full of graffiti and billboards to give off the sense of an urban setting. A gate surrounds the band, and during encores, a train carrying bright screens stops by to add to the lights of the venue. Club Boston. The player finds themselves in a dark, enclosed electric generator, where, you guessed it, electricity flies all over the place as the band plays some electric tunes. During encores, the electricity powers up and bashes against the core in the back of the venue. Sideshow. A circus filled with illustrations of the odd performers and carnival-esque items. Players can notice some of the weird things happening around them, such as the cage monster reaching towards the band and a brain in a jar. During encores, Ivan, the world's strongest man, lifts a dumbbell with many speakers sitting upon it. Angel's Crypt. A cemetery that takes place in New Orleans, full of spooky imagery such as the angel statues and tombstones. A wicked vibe fills the venue. During encores, spirits break out and fly around the stage and music goers. O'Connell's Corner. This venue takes players to Dublin, Ireland, where they're surrounded by the color green and Irish folklore, such as leprechauns and four-leaf clovers. Screens sit behind the band, along with projections that display the aforementioned Irish folklore. Players can notice people passing by, and people dining in the pub surrounding the band. The Aqueduct. Under a major highway lays this small but stout stage where their band plays a little show for the most loyal of fans. The scenery is reminiscent of cars and motors. Guitar Hedge. A parody of Stonehenge, with huge guitar heads standing with no rhyme or reason. And just like Stonehenge, it's in the middle of nowhere. During encores, a calling beyond this world happens, and weird lights show up above the band. Neon Oasis. A junkyard filled with New Vegas-like signs and icons surround this stage. Players can notice the clutter in the outer field of the venue, along with a billboard afar. While the decor may have been abandoned or thrown away, they still have a lot of life in them, and will show off their vibrant colors. During encores, the stage below the drummer opens up and flashes bright colors. Electric Honky Tonk. A hip and modern club set on one of the highest floors of a Nashville building. Players can even see the outside through the windows and the back of the venue. Flashing TVs show off many of animations of people dancing, among other things. During encores, sparks fly, and the screens behind the band change to a nighttime aesthetic. Calavera Square. This venue takes place in Mexico City, Mexico, with Dia de los Muertos imagery such as decorated skulls and papeles picados. There's even a huge skull that sits behind the band, and the stage itself looks like a tomb. During encores, this huge skull opens up, and a mariachi band of skeletons is revealed. Cairo Bazaar. An Egyptian venue, as evidenced by the pyramids in the back and hieroglyphics. The band plays at a mesa, where sparks fly from the decorations around the band, and the stage lights up with color. During encores, the mask behind the band turns over and shows its rather surreal side. The Golden Gate. The band plays on a platform under the famous Californian Bridge, surrounded by water, where the concertgoers cheer on the band on small boats. Occasionally, the camera will pan to the actual Golden Gate, where they can see cars fly by. Fjord of Swords. This level takes place in Greenland, with Nordic imagery and Viking themes plastered all over the place. And because it takes place in Greenland, there's snow everywhere, and the band warms up their fans by blasting some insane melodies. Players can notice that the characters will exhale mist due to the cold weather. Just look at the singer, as he exhales the most. During encores, a dragon appears behind the band and enjoys the performance, while also spewing fire. Hypersphere. The band stands on essentially nothing, as all types of shapes, figures, and colors appear behind the band with no rhyme or reason. Wormhole. This venue looks sort of like a screensaver, with the venue reacting to the music being played on screen. It looks close to the Tool venue from World Tour. Personally, I believe the venues in this game and overall art direction are way better than World Tour. It's just more fitting and full of things for players to jot their eyes to. Let's move on to the animations in this game. And just like the venues, the animations in this game are also pretty good. They're very lifelike and appropriate to the instrument being played. The guitarists and bassists have their own microphones this time, so they don't have to use the vocalist microphone in order to sing their part of the song. The transitions that occur after a song ends is quite smooth, with the stats of each player's performance, followed by a screen that counts up the total amount of stars earned. Anyways, let's talk about the characters. The characters this time around are awesome. They have good design and plenty of polish. Not to mention, all the characters that are usable from the start of the game have alternative outfits players can unlock via the aforementioned challenges, and they also look pretty good. Players can even have the same character playing multiple instruments in their band. So what about the new characters? Well, the real-life musicians in this game look quite fine with their apparel and the way they portray their personality, but the secret characters are kinda weird. Before we do that, I do have to mention there are no new characters that are unlocked from the start. They all have to be unlocked one way or another. Also, with the exception of Skeleton, none of the new faces from World Tour reappear. But honestly, good riddance. They weren't that great. Also, I couldn't show these characters on a character select screen. As such, I'll just show these characters off in gameplay. Frankenrocker. He's not exactly Frankenstein's monster, but he is a monster rocking out and playing legendary performances. Frankenrocker looks like a punk version of Frankenstein's monster, with his mohawk and torn apparel. Golden God. A naked dude that's gold all over. He lacks a fully defined face, as he's missing eyes and other details. There's also Shadow, who's just Golden God, but he's black all over. Shirley Manson. The vocalist from Garbage appears in Club Boston to show off her talent in singing with their hit song, Only Happy When It Rains. Matthew Bellamy. The singer and guitarist from the popular rock band Muse shows up to play Plugin Baby at O'Connell's Corner. Kurt Cobain. Nirvana's frontman, songwriter, vocalist, and guitarist arrives to perform Smells Like Teen Spirit and Lithium. Johnny Cash. The ever-so-famous country musician shows up to the Electric Honky Tonk to play Ring of Fire with his iconic haircut and suit. Carlos Santana. Known for his mixture of Latin American styles of music with rock, Santana makes a scene at Calavera Square to play No One to Depend On. Whenever one of these guest appearances songs are played, the other members from that band also appear and play their appropriate instrument, although they aren't playable in other game modes. Like the musicians in World Tour, the real-life people in Guitar Hero 5 are pretty close to their counterparts in the real world, in terms of their personality on stage and apparel. Speaking of apparel, let's move on to the Create a Character mode. The Create a Character mode isn't too much different than World Tour's. All the features and modifications players can make are still intact. Guitar Hero 5 has a larger number of outworldly and cool accessories and clothing than World Tour. A lot of the hat accessories are pretty cool. I mean, look at this pumpkin head. A jack-o'-lantern as a head? Yes, please. Also, the female custom characters were given some cool accessories too, which was something World Tour lacked. The Create an Instrument mode has a bit more options than World Tour, but the choice of using a custom fretboard is absent. The default fretboard is used for every character and instrument. Guitar Hero 5's setlist isn't as varied as World Tour's, but honestly, it works better that way. In my opinion, World Tour is just trying to be a little too much like Rock Band 1 in its song selection, and 5 decides to fix this by selecting songs that really fit with everything Guitar Hero is known for. Live songs return, along with a few remixes. You and Me by Attack Attack, not the metal band, was included due to the band winning a contest where bands would submit a new song to Neversoft, and Neversoft would choose which song to include. World Tour didn't have a bad set list, it's just some of the songs didn't really fit that well with Guitar Hero. The sound effects in this game are a lot more impactful. The song result screen always gets me pumped. They have a lot more energy and oomph to them than pretty much every other Guitar Hero game. Other than that, there isn't a lot to say about the sound department of Guitar Hero 5. Guitar Hero 5 lacks in terms of extras. Of course, there's the cheats players can mess around with, along with some extra modifiers, and DLC. Before I go into the issues of this game, I'm going to briefly go over the version differences. Normally I talk about version differences in a section separate from the extras slash issues segment, but there isn't many to warrant its own section. The Wii version is what you expect. It plays just like the PS3 and Xbox 360 versions with its intact DLC and online play, but can only run at 480p. The Wii version has an exclusive venue called Station Terminus, which is a dance club. Station Terminus is unlocked through the Roadie mode of the Wii version. Roadie mode is whenever a player hooks up one or two DSs and fights against a friend or a bot in a guitar battle. The player uses their DS to battle against the other person by sabotaging their playing. The PS2 version runs the same way World Tour ran, with its terrible graphics but smooth gameplay. It lacks a lot of the new features of the PS3 and 360 versions, including the Rockfest mode and party play. There's an exclusive robot character, Fembot, who is just a female version of Metalhead. The Xbox 360 version allows for players to use their Xbox Live avatar during gameplay, and it looks goofy as all hell. That's all the version differences I could come up with, so onto the issues. Guitar Hero 5 is kind of easy. It still has its difficult songs, but they really fall short to what previous games had. The engine of this game also feels a little off. I'm not exactly sure what it is. I think at least within the hitbox and time window. The real-life musicians are just vocalists and guitarists. There's no drummers or bassists. It would have been really nice to have just a bit more variety, especially since this game is full band. While the vocal system looks really nice, it's kind of hard to tell how high or how low the player needs to change their singing if they're not hitting the notes right. Also, some of the phrases feel short. All they really needed to do was just make some of them a tad longer, and the vocal system would have felt a bit more fair. While the venues and graphics of this game look incredible, the encores are lackluster, and most of the time don't really add anything. I would also like to add, I wish there was band presets in this game, so that I could change my band members without having to manually change every single one of them. I wouldn't say these issues ruin the game, but they're definitely noticeable. Well, that's all I had to say about this game's shortcomings. Guitar Hero 5 is perhaps the most lackluster game in the series in terms of gameplay, but it's still plenty of fun, the visuals look great, and the music setlist just makes sense. It doesn't have a lot of extras, and it has a handful of issues, but it's still a worthwhile game that has a lot to offer if the player has all the instruments and wants to beat all the challenges. Let's count everything up that Guitar Hero 5 has to offer. Revamped gameplay that spices up the full band gameplay from World Tour. 85 songs that are a little too easy to beat in 5-star, a career mode that good players can breeze through and unlock all sorts of stuff through the challenges, 4 new fun and unique multiplayer modes, 14 venues that are full of detail and personality, 20 characters that have amazing design and a good amount of alternative outfits, a significantly better Create a Rocker mode, many new options with awesome accessories for both male and female custom characters, and a good bunch of extras and cheat codes. Guitar Hero 5 is fun, there's no doubt about that, but it doesn't hold up that much in innovation. It has its new ideas that work, but they're not perfect, and lacked in many ways. But until next time, continue rocking on with 4 of your friends, and all hail the Hypersphere.